Okay, now for the center of tonight's presentation, which is the national lecture. And this year, our national lecturer is Klaus Schulten from the University of Illinois in Urbana-Champaign. So Klaus is a very distinguished scientist. I can't list all of his awards. He's a fellow of the APS. He received the 2013 Distinguished Service Award from the Biophysical Society. He's a BPS fellow. He's the director of the NIH Center for Macromolecular Modeling and Bioinformatics. Anyone who in the computational field, I'm sure, or even anyone who looks at protein structures is familiar with VMD and the service, the incredible service that that has provided to the field. He, of course, is an expert in theory and computation, but I think equally important, and I think this actually, I was having a discussion with Kamal about this today, equally important is that he appreciates the importance of the integration of theory and simulation with experiment. When I was growing up as a scientist and I worked in Gary Aker's lab, one of the things that he really emphasized to us was that the only way for science and particularly biophysics to advance is through the iterative process or the discussion between theory and experiment. Theory can yield results that will inspire experiments, and then the experimental results will be used to refine the theory. And I think that it's very, and I think that actually Klaus epitomizes this. His work has covered problems from small-scale interactions of proteins with nucleic acids to protein folding to enormous systems like the HIV capsid and the photosynthetic light harvesting complex. So without further ado, I don't want to spend, I don't want to take too much time away from his lecture. I am very pleased to introduce Klaus Schulten as this year's national lecturer, the highest award that the society provides each year, and he's going to talk to us about discoveries in biophysics through the computational microscope.
Thank you. Great, perfect. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your kind words, Dorothy.
I feel extremely honored because I love the Biophysical Society and the Biophysical Journal and the annual meeting. And when I look at the list of previous national lecturers, and I feel dwarfed, and I try my best. So let's go. Here you see the hinterland on the it's between Chicago, Indianapolis, and St. Louis, where the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign is located. And I would like to begin with some key thank yous. And maybe I start with the former ones. We enjoyed funding for many years, and the stability of the funding clearly contributed to the success that I can tell you about tonight. And on one side, it's from the National Science Foundation. And I was very, very glad to see Kamal Shukla being honored here. And he is described as a great leader. It's easy to say, but let me give you an example. So when I came with my wife, she's a professor of chemistry, also working in biophysics, to the US, we both wrote proposals to the National Science Foundation. The same cycle, and so they landed on Kamal's desk. And one day I get a phone call from him. And he said, here's Kamal Shukla. My heart stopped beating. What is he going to tell me now? And he said, Klaus, I heard his sort of like a stark voice. Klaus, I got two proposals from Illinois, but I can only fund one. The one from your wife or you, whom should I fund? Oh my God, I thought then, oh, my startup was a little higher than my wife's. And so I said then, okay, fund Zan. Then I heard the voice on the phone, right answer, I fund you both. So. So that was my beginning with Kamal, and he really was extremely supportive in any way you can imagine. And today, for example, I'm co-director of a National Science Foundation Physics Frontier Center called the Physics of Living Cells, and that is funded by the Physics Division of the National Science Foundation as well as by the Molecular Cell Biology Division under Kamal Shukla. And so we have been very, very supportive with that center, and that I would like to point out here. I also need to point to some very long-term funding that I received as a center director from the National Institute of Health for now 25 years. And so that kind of long-range investment into technology, because computing is very much technology linked, is very important to be successful. But of course, most important are the people, and I enjoyed very much over the years to have an excellent research group, and that particularly also applies to the present group. The present group I must thank very, very much, because our science came to screeching halt about a month ago, when everybody chimed in to assist me with slides for this presentation tonight. And first I thought it was crazy, and maybe some of my group members too, but when I see how many people are here, then I'm glad that we put in the work. If it doesn't work out well, it's all my fault. So this slide here pretty much tells the story of my lecture, the development of computational biology at the molecular level over the years 1990 to 2015. And it's connected with increasing size scale. That sounds first a little bit like a macho thing, but if you translate this size scale going from describing systems with 10,000 atoms to systems of over 100 million atoms. Then if you go look at the volume, then it was a 2 nanometer cubed volume, which is about the volume of a protein, to 100 nanometer cubed now, which is about a thousandth of a small cell. And so what you see is a development that is really at the heart of biology. Biology is about systems that are alive, and the smallest living system is a cell, and the cell has a certain size. It's a society of many, many biomolecules, of, for example, several hundred thousand proteins, several hundred million proteins in a cell. And so by going to larger systems, we become in many ways more biological, and that is what I want to show you. Benchmarks on that way was the first time we could simulate a protein in a membrane. When we reached the size of 100,000 atom simulations, we could then embed the protein in a membrane and describe it in its real environment. We reached then a million atom mark and could describe for the first time an entire virus with a virus capsid and the RNA content. We reached 3 million to describe the entire ribosome, and then around 100 million we could describe entire viral capsids, large viral capsid of very relevant diseases, and the first entire organelle. So let me now follow this course, but first remind you that to go that way and to use to do computing, you need tools. And the tools should be looked at with a little lightheartedness, because we have to make discoveries with our tools. And even though the computers we use today cost, the last one that we are using, $200 million, we still need to be very playful about them. And so our program NEMDI, which is our simulation program that has about 70,000 users as judged by downloads and availability at big centers, is really a tool to explore. As the title of my lecture indicated, to use the computer as a computational microscope. And if you look then at our marks over the years, and we started with small parallel computers. We used a very modern computer language like C++. We went into bigger parallel computers to do more atoms. We were one of the first scientists at all who used graphics processing units for poor man's powerful computers. And today we use petascale supercomputers, which are these $200 million beasts. The computing is not only determined, though, by hardware. If you ask anybody in the field of computing, they will tell you that most of the speed up comes actually from ideas, from mathematics and algorithms. And so over the last 20 years, we wrote 50 method papers that were sort of key events in suggesting new concepts and suggesting new algorithms. I just would like to point it out so that you don't get the idea that the computer is sort of like a push button kind of thing. In fact, in my group, people who push the button run the program are called the monkeys, and nobody wants to be a monkey. So an example was actually reported this morning by Zi Wu, a postdoc in my group, namely the multi-level summation method, which is a completely new method to calculate Coulomb interactions. Coulomb interactions are, of course, very important, and you need to count them very accurately. But they take most of the computer resources away when you're doing simulations, and having now a completely new method that is faster on the latest generation of computers is a big event, a real revolution. The other program is VMD. And some people think that VMD is for pretty pictures, but no, it's really a tool to think. That is how we look at it. And so here we see, of course, the pictures too, but this is Ilya Folofyov from Odense in Denmark. And he is showing how to use a VMD. Now, VMD is particularly good for molecular dynamics because it can actually visualize not only static structures, but whatever you do for a static structure, you can also do for a dynamic structure. For example, here you see in blue the hydrogen bonds calculated, you see the secondary structure calculated, the surface of a protein, some chemical groups. So whatever you do in one frame in time, you can do all over in terms of depiction, but also in terms of analysis. You can do that for small proteins, and also you can do it for very large macromolecular systems, like this one that you see here. So this is a very impressive system, and I know what all of you think. you think this is an Illinois cornfield. But no, this is really a very, very interesting system. It was actually covered here yesterday in a platform. This is a chemotactic array of bacteria, the brain of bacteria. And so this is no problem, even on your own laptop, to visualize such large systems with VMD. Now, I said it's not just a program to do pretty pictures, but I can tell you, as a little sales pitch, that it's wonderful to get cover illustrations. So we have them all lined up, and you can do well. And the latest VMD has even more beautiful ways of doing images. But let's go back to the tool to sync thing. So there is something in VMD that are called plugins, that are tools to set up simulations and to analyze simulations. Actually, they are developed in-house, but about one-third of them, and actually some of the most impressive and most useful ones, are actually contributed by external users. So this is really a community effort that holds equally for NMD. And so this is really wonderful, the community of computational biology, even though we have some kind of competing programs. In principle, it's really a very supportive society that shares tools very freely. So just to show you a few examples of these useful plugins, the first one is when you want to simulate a new compound, you need to find what are called force field parameters for it. Let's say you are in pharmacology and you have a new drug that you want to try out, a new candidate. And you need to find the force field. That's usually a very long job to do. Even for a real expert, it takes many weeks often to do all kinds of quantum chemistry calculations. And this is now being done by this FFTK in the sense that the user gets supported so that an expert can do a job in a day, at most two, that used to take many weeks. Another job is to calculate energies. You call that free energy methods. And so you calculate, for example, energy barriers. You calculate binding energies. You can also calculate how much energy it would take to change an amino acid in a certain structure. That's called alchemical free energy. And that is a tool that is also available and much used in VMD, actually making use also of NMD. Here's a program that is a typical external program. Namely, it is developed by Yvette Baha and colleagues at the University of Pittsburgh. It's called Normal Mode Wizard. It helps you to organize a calculation of normal modes for your macromolecule and to visualize the normal modes. So they developed some great tools in Pittsburgh, and now they become all available in the VMD user interface so that the VMD user doesn't have to learn anything new. He or she is in a familiar environment. And last but not least, that gets me actually to the first science part of my lecture, is a tool called Timeline that monitors events in a very long simulation as it arises when you fold proteins in a computer. You see the shadow protein, you see that this folded protein goes straight to the shadow, so it folds correctly onto the crystal structure. And this timeline tool monitors, for example, in this case, secondary structure, and you can then see at which moments the secondary structure becomes perfect, and what are the intermediates on the way to there. And so this is what you can do. You're getting the protein correctly described. But then you ask, you know, what did we learn? We agree with experiment. Is that any good? The answer is we see the process. That is all with almost the same with molecular dynamics. Experiments give you static structures or averages of dynamic constant, but very little the kind of detailed information that you really want to know to understand macromolecular processes. And this is what the simulation does. It tells you the detail, and in this case, it tells you the folding pathway. So in this particular simple case, we have, at the very end, three key intermediates where this last helix that was wrongly directed for a long time, the little red end here, then is finally put in the right direction. And that's sort of like the key stumbling block, actually, for this particular Villain headpiece folding. So there are many people in the field of protein folding using simulations. Vijay Pandey at Stanford, for example, with folding at home, or David Shaw and co-workers with the Anton 1 and now the Anton 2 machine. And we ourselves had the first 10 microsecond simulation of protein folding. We pointed out weaknesses in the force field that needed to be addressed to simulate folding a little better. We did also the first 100 microsecond simulations, but today it is the other Anton machines that are really very capable of folding proteins, you know, 100 amino acid or so. And so though the folding field has become really rigorous field on the theoretical computational side, that you can really see in detail what happens. Now the value is seen when you go beyond folding protein just for their own sake. When you are looking at pathological situations, one of the worst ones is actually protein misfolding as it's connected with central nervous system disease situations, like in Alzheimer, where you have a beta amyloid fibrils. And here you see a folding event described that involves folding and aggregating to an existing fibril tip. And this was made possible through an MD simulation with a trick, though. This is a one millisecond simulation that we achieved by simplifying, coarse graining the solvent, but not the protein. The protein is pretty much described at the atomic level, but not the solvent. And that permits us to do quite a few simulations, including some that are incredibly relevant. And they, for example, describe the proper geometry of the fibril. They also show at which tip the growth is faster. The tip has two asymmetric ends, and so on. So I had to divide my lecture into sections because it's a huge file. So I was afraid if something doesn't work to get into trouble. So I have to now begin with my next section. So I talked about protein folding. And the opposite of protein folding is unfolding, stretching a protein out. And that actually happens also naturally when you exert forces on proteins. And one typical case are the proteins in muscle. We all know actin and myosin, but there is a third protein in muscle called titin. Titin is actually the longest protein with the longest gene in the human genome. Even though we have many, many different muscles, we only have one titin because it's so long and complex that it's through post-processing that it adjusts itself to the various types. Until you see how in an atomic force microscopy experiment, when you see this would be the folding and this is unfolding, how one can stretch a protein out. And you will appreciate also that unfolding is much easier than folding. To break something is easy. And that is really literally true in the sense that this was a dramatically productive period in molecular simulations when these mechanical properties of proteins were investigated. It all went back, though, to a difficult time. It started with an experiment in the laboratory of Hermann Graup in Munich. And you see here the experiment. And they took this one domain of Titan, Titan I-27 in the old days and I-91 now. And they stretched it, and they found that after 5 angstrom about of stretching, the protein broke in a way. They call it rupture. And then you could very easily unravel it until you had it completely stretched out. And then, of course, it became very hard, and you came then to a standstill. And so this was the experiment. And a year later, we published the simulation that just did exactly the same. So here's the beginning of the stretching. And so you see that very quickly the protein becomes taut and very straight. And then when you stretch a little bit more, you're getting over hump. And here I go forward and backward over the hump to just show you what is happening as we go over this rupture event. What happens is that we have here about 8 hydrogen bonds that are shown here as cigarettes, these purple cigarettes, and they are all broken at one time. Through a shearing force, we break 8 hydrogen bonds that secure the stability of the protein. If we go more, then if you go further, then we see that in the next step, it's easy to do the rest, because then we unzip the hydrogen bonds one by one by one. That's very easy. And so you see really that that we could reproduce this experiment early, an early rupture peak in the force versus extension, and then low forces. But you would think that, oh, the people would have greeted us with jubilation, but the opposite happened. People said, oh, whatever dirty word, look at it. You are pulling the protein at a speed that is 10 orders of magnitude, look at here on the bottom, 10 orders of magnitude faster than the experiment. And your force that you calculate, look at this value here, is 20 times larger than what is measured. So that is all garbage. And so we don't want to listen to you. We said, yeah, we do it much faster, yes, but the rupture happens right away. And so what can go wrong there? We just, within 5 angstrom, we pull it apart. And, you know, we don't think anything happened. But you cannot believe what kind of referee reports we got and what happened. Now, however, the science was actually much nicer to us than you may think, because what happened now is that actually the experimentalists were impressed with the detail we saw. We tried harder to get closer to the experiment, and so we met. The meeting actually only happened in 2013, and so you see there the experiments that were done on the experimental side in red and purple, and on the blues are the how we slowed down the simulations in order to find common ground. And you see there is sort of like a tendency, and there's also a theory that we developed to describe the relationship between the potential of mean force and the extension. And a simple model of this kind of folding event was suggested by Hummer and Szabo. And you see it follows very nicely this trend. With other words, yes, we were faster because we pulled faster, the forces were higher, but we basically describe all the time the same process. And so we agreed with experiment, but again you ask, you know, okay, for what? No, partially I told you already what happened. Here is the protein again, and if we pull it, you know, we find very quickly the force becomes strong, and then as we go over the hump, we are seeing now that the protein is protected through a large number of hydrogen bonds that need to be broken at the same time. And when we continued this work, we found many, many likewise beta strain systems that have sometimes hundreds of hydrogen bonds that are aligning themselves in a way that any force that is applied biologically to the system would have to break many hydrogen bonds at the same time, and so the system is protected. Here you see the results we got. Who? No, I cover there. You see, we had a wonderful paper in Nature with Julio Fernandez and our group, where we mutated the system with these hydrogen bonds by mutating some of them away, and then we could really show that we at will could modify the rupture force. We also find, to our great surprise, that water molecules play a key role. So when my students were doing these calculations, I was often yelling at them, "Why is nothing happening in the computer? What are you doing wrong? What's crazy?" And later we realized that even in the computer, we had to wait that there were enough of these hydrogen bonds being broken by water that constantly attack them. About once per picosecond, they are breaking each of these hydrogen bonds, but always separately. And so the water play a very important role. The forces only shift the balance. So the titanium molecule is has many domains. And so we began then to study also an entire piece of titin. We were fortunate to work with Olga Mayans at the time in Basel, who had crystallized then a six-domain piece of titin. And so then we could see actually how the titin as a whole works. And so you see here, that is, you must imagine now the same for 300 domains. How this protein develops, how this long protein with many, many domains develops its elasticity. And it turns out that the description of this quite complex system is actually very simple, because during this process, we have actually complete equilibrium except for the end-to-end distance that is constrained by the force. The rest of the system is at equilibrium because this force is generated over timescales where the sub-degrees of freedom are well equilibrated. So we can describe basically what you see there through some, you know, just experts of you know a little bit thermodynamics, so simple thermodynamics expressions. And we get a nice agreement with the overall elastic behavior of the system, not only for six domains, but for many more domains. And we can calculate the force extension curve, and we're getting this great agreement. So you have on one side these complicated simulations, but on the other side, you are led through them to some deeper understanding. So now the most recent case of mechanical systems and forces relating to gut bacteria that you find in this particular case of this bacterium in the rumen of a cow. And there you have the cow eats the grass, and the grass has cellulose fibrils, and they are very hard to digest. And we also have gut bacteria that help us to digest food that that our metabolism cannot digest, and they are broken down by the bacteria to a level that then come product that we can take care of. Now, these bacteria have on their surfaces a tentacle-like system of proteins called cellulosomes. And these cellulosomes are very, very modularly built, so that you can put at some of them enzymes that take care of the particular cellulose fibers that you just encounter in the habitat of the bacterium. And some of them are just anchor points to the biomass, to the cellulose fibers to keep you on there. And these bonds are very interesting. They are a prime example of what you call a catch bond. You can easily plug them together and apart, together and apart. You can modify them, no problem. But once you use them, they are in the room of the cow, and the liquids flow and pull and poke, then the bond becomes very strong. And here we have again a situation, another collaboration with Hermann Gaub in Munich, where on one side we have the experiment that measures this adhesion bond between cohesin and docarin of the cellulovome. We are far away with the simulation, but we did enough experiments that we could extrapolate towards where the simulation predicted the rupture force. But now the simulation tells you what makes this bond so strong. And now you have to watch here carefully. What we do now is we apply the force, we release the force, we apply the force, release the force, we apply the force, release the force, and then we pull it apart. And the first moments show you that initially the contact is loose, but once we apply force, you would expect it becomes looser, but the opposite happens, the contact becomes stronger. And so here you see it. So you see, strong, loose, and strong it becomes when we pull. And so now we pull very strong, we go faster with the movie, and so then when we pull them too strong, then they break. The strength of the force is that almost of a chemical, of a covalent chemical bond. And so here you see again the typical advantage of the computer simulation. It doesn't only agree with the experiment, but it tells you more. It tells you usually the process. And that's why many, many people, many experimental papers actually also include today simulations. So here we have now simulations as your competitor. So basically, we also want to do discoveries. We don't only want to make discoveries where you experimentalists are the leaders. And so this situation arose a few years ago when a protein was structurally solved that contained a segment of a protein called ankyrin. Ankyrin is a very, very common protein motif, for example, in human proteins and in many other proteins. And so this was quite an exciting moment. People immediately thought this is probably connected with some mechanosensory device. And so when the structure came out, the atomic force microscopy people jumped it, and the simulation people jumped it. And here you see the simulation, and it was published in 2005. The first experiment was done in 2006, studying exactly what you see here, namely, what is actually the elastic constant, the spring constant for this ankyrin. And what we found, it was 5 millinewton per meter. That may not mean much to you, but if you would put a coffee bean on a spring with that kind of spring constant, the spring would extend by 1 meter in the gravitational field. So it's a very, very soft spring. And that's exactly what they found in experiment. We are off by a factor 2, but the main point is here that we were in a ballpark of a soft spring that was completely surprising. A year later, actually, experiments also studied what I don't show here, which we simulated, what happens when you pull stronger on this ankyrin, then you unravel the protein, and the signature that we saw there was also seen. Both papers cited the simulation, so we were very happy because we like to make our own discoveries and we want to be before the experiment at least once in a while to get to full glory. So here we have another mechanical system, very, very common in the human body, cadherins. We have 110 different cadherins. Many of them are the so-called classical cadherins. They organize epithelial tissue, like, for example, the human gut system. And without cadherins, the gut would fall apart and we would actually be soup. And here you see that you can make one cadherin-free soup. And it was known before the simulation that calcium actually has a big influence on cadherin. So at the right moment, calcium, it controls a lot. And one is that without calcium, cadherin is very flexible. With calcium, it is much less so. That was known before, and that was reproduced nicely in the simulation. But what was not known before was that also the elastic rigidity of cadherin is affected by calcium, particularly also the rupture forces. And so here you see the simulation results in 2008, and experiment is from 2011. And so again, we have here a situation that we actually went ahead of the experiment. So now I want to continue, and I come now to the next big mark, which is the mark where we reach the 100,000 atom simulations, where we could for the first time simulate membrane processes. And so let me now go to study membrane proteins, or to the discussion of it. And so, no. Here. Didn't have to switch. So here we are. Here we have the protein aquaporin. So the protein was discovered by Peter Agre, who got the Nobel Prize in 2003 together with McKinnon. You see here the aquaporin as it is simulated in a membrane. And you see how the water forms a single file conduction. Aquaporin is a tetramer, so there are four of these channels. And when you look at in the simulation, when you look at them, then you find the water molecules are actually very clearly oriented because there is a very strong quadrupolar field inside the protein. The water molecules come first oxygen in, then they turn around and leave oxygen last. And now this was our discovery, and we tried to get it published. People were very critical if you could trust us. This was actually a collaboration with Bob Strout in San Francisco. And so the only way that the editor let us get through was that he gave us a very tough task to add mutations to the aquaporin, predict the positions of the water molecules jumping from position to position, even though they look like they go continuously, and then do the crystallography. And if we could report that we agreed again, then he would take the paper. It worked very well, and the paper got out. Got a lot of attention, in fact, a little bit too much for my taste, because at the night of before the Nobel Prize was awarded, I got the the 4 o'clock phone call from Stockholm. But I was warned a few hours before, Klaus, there will be a phone call for you from Stockholm, but it's not what you think. And so I was then asked by the Nobel Committee if they could show the movie. So I would say that I'm very honored that they show the movie. Okay, very good. So now you see the water molecules have a very strict orientation, and this sort of juxtaposition of the orientation, when you little think about it, doesn't permit that protons can jump between the water molecules like in ice, and jump from one to the other and thereby conduct. So the aquaporin conducts water well, but no protons. We did then a collaboration with Greg Voss, who did then a wonderful quantum chemical calculation, valence bond kind of calculation, that showed then the barrier, one hump being due to a Coulomb charge, positively charged side group that is sort of like a gatekeeper, and then the main effect from this orientation of the water molecules. And so this is actually incredibly impressive, because the water molecules in aquaporin, they go, even though they are checked not to take a proton along, they go there incredibly fast at the 1/10 of the speed of free diffusion. And so when you go to the airport, you would really feel very, very happy if they could frisk you at that speed. You know, you just don't have to stand there, but you just go a little slow, and then it would work. And so maybe they can learn something from aquaporin. And so here's what I think they can learn. They just have to orient people. And so maybe that works then better. At least it works in aquaporin. And actually, it's more serious than it looks, because it is a narrow space and the Coulomb field, which doesn't permit anything else but water molecules and actually small linear alcohols to electrostatically rotate around. Anything bigger needs to, just like an ocean liner, rotate and takes too much space and cannot get through this protein. Okay, so there's also an interesting technical side to these kind of simulations. And you can use today biological pores, but also engineered pores as sensors. Particularly, people are very interested in using them for cheap and fast DNA sequencing. And so here is wonderful story with Amit Mella. He was then at Boston University, and he was one of the leaders in the field. And I approached him and said, Amit, I would really like to work with you. I want to get into this field. And can I simulate something for you? And he said, okay, Klaus, sure, but you have to first pass a test. And so which test? Tell me, when single-stranded DNA goes through my alpha-hemolysin pore, which end goes faster, when it goes 3' first or 5' first? Oh, I thought it might have been a trick question, because he expected the answer, of course, it doesn't matter. But I had at the time an excellent postdoc, today my colleague, Alek Aksimentiev. And so in 3 weeks' time, we figured it out, and we found, to our surprise, it goes much faster 3' first. So I picked up the phone and I said, Amit, 3' is faster. And on the other side of the phone, he said, yes, but why? So we had seen it, but he had no possible idea how this could come about. And here it is. Nobody knew this, even though, you know, the DNA is dangling in front of our nose since so many years, that when you have the basis of single-stranded DNA, they actually have a certain natural tilt to them, not from the nature of the basis, but rather from the sugar rings. And so when you put them in a confined space, they all tilt in the same direction. And so now if you look at this thing, it's like an umbrella that is opened to this angle, and we all know which way we can get through a narrow door with that umbrella. It's much better to go tip first than to go handle first. And so this is a simple reason, some overlooked property of the backbone sugars in DNA that gave rise to this effect. Now, jumping forward to 2015, we are now working actually with some of the leading companies in DNA sequencing, and we try to find devices and through simulation and through quantum chemical calculations, we find the best possible measuring method. And one of them is that we actually measure the current that is induced in a graphene sheet through which DNA is threaded. And we can count already the bases, and we hope that we can also recognize the bases. We're not there, maybe never get there, but you know, it's already some step taken. So, so now I passed the the membrane proteins, and now I'm going a big step forward to the million to 100 million atom simulations, namely, first I go to the ribonome. We go now to 3 million atom simulations. So we want to think about how actually these membrane proteins get into the membrane when they are made by the ribosome. And so here we have three systems. We have we see a ribosome three times sitting on top of a membrane and having a nascent protein that is just being synthesized. One time, it's a very simple protein, a serine protein of an ATPase that is just a double, is a, just a hairpin made of two alpha helices. So a very simple one. Next one is a little bit more complicated, bacteriolopsin, that is being synthesized and put in the membrane. And the last one is a whole ATPase with A and B and whatever stalks you have to get to hold the system in the membrane. And so whatever you have, it's the same ribosome. It uses the same mechanism of synthesizing the protein, but it uses different helper proteins, chaperones, to put that that new protein into the membrane. And so let me show what we can do there. And so here we have the simplest case, and there the protein that is involved is called YTSI. It docks to the ribosome, and we see here the nascent protein in green, and we see the chaperone YTSI in red. And now we worked with Roland Beckmann at the Gene Center in Munich, who studied this system through electron microscopy. And he had not too good resolution, but pretty good resolution, picture of the system. And we predicted the structure of this protein and then tried to fit it into his electron microscopy density. And here you see the result. You see it fits quite nicely into the density. Now, how did we do this, that we utilize the density and get a fit? So for the structure prediction, we used actually a program called MuFold, which is not as well known as Rosetta, but in the competition, it did very, very well, particularly in automated prediction, which we like to do because we don't want to get too much ourselves into the folding field. So we just predicted the structure and we fit it in there and looked pretty good. Now, how do we do the fitting? We developed a method called molecular dynamics flexible fitting, and it works as follows, that on one side, we have some information, like from crystallography, in this case, of the entire ribosome, but then the protein we got from prediction. So you have a mixture of sources for the protein you would like to put into the electron density. On the other side, you have an electron density, and so we put the two together, and this is what we get. We try to fit it, and now the point is that we not only take the crystallographic and the predictive structure on one side of the electron density, we take more. We take more. And what we take is the combined wisdom of 30 years of molecular dynamics, where people developed force fields that represent better and better the actual physical characteristics and chemical characteristics of biological macromolecules. So we add this knowledge to the process, and that gives us this calculation. So there is really knowledge, structural information, electron microscopy information together give you this result. Now, does it work? Yes, I think so. We have 70 reported applications of the molecular dynamics flexible fitting method, short MDFF. Here you see a few of them from our own laboratory, pretty reasonable journals. Here you see them from extramural researchers that were not connected with us. When we saw the publications, we were positively, of course, surprised. And so you see the method is actually working quite well in our hands and in other people's hands. Now, how did we do in this particular case? Now, here we were lucky and unlucky. It's a time when we submitted our publication together with the Beckman group. We became aware that there was also a crystal structure submitted, not in complex with a ribosome, but by itself. And so it shouldn't be exactly like our structure, but you know, pretty close. And here you see the comparison, the red and the blue the crystal structure, you see that with a little deformation, which you would expect because they are really, one is a functional structure in a membrane, you know, with small lipids and with a ribosome, so it shouldn't be exactly the same, and it's a very, very nice comparison. And so it looked like we got it right. So let's go to the next bigger case. The next bigger case happened actually before the small case, where we have a protein called SEC-Y, or some people also call it translocon, that is the helper protein for nascent membrane proteins. And so here you see the membrane protein, and you see then SEC-Y and SEC-E taking care of putting the protein inside there. And the question here is now, what did we learn? And it's a very interesting answer I give you. The answer I give you is the following, that when you do this kind of calculation that I just described now with molecular dynamics flexible fitting, at the end, you do not only have a structure, you also have a starting point. The starting point is you can now simulate the system and investigate its method. How can it actually move a nascent protein that is put inside a channel through a side gate that you find in the protein into the membrane phase? And so that would be what we did. The great hero there was J.C. Gumbart, who is, I'm sure, is in the audience. I throw him around. And he published together with me, but now he's at his own group in the Georgia Tech by himself. And we made one very important realization, very simple one, but only when you are, you know, really doing very concrete simulations do you begin to think straight. Very often when you are in the abstract, you leave out a few, often the simplest factors. And what we left out before we did the work was that actually the ribosome is some kind of protein pump. It synthesizes the protein, one amino acid group at a time, some faster, some more slowly, like proline is usually a very slowly integrated amino acid in the ribosome. But, you know, they are being manufactured and being squeezed like toothpaste into this protein here. And this velocity is important. And so when we want to understand the partitioning between inside of the translocon and outside, we must take the finiteness of the time into account that is available for the process. So equilibrium concepts can be very misleading. So finally, the biggest of them all for the most complex membrane proteins is called the holocomplex. It actually involves YTC, it involves the translocon and some other proteins. And this is a project that we are just beginning. This is a collaboration with the Schaffitzer group at Embel in Grenoble. But you see now that typical for molecular dynamics simulations, you can study processes rather than just static things. Here, the process of actually integrating proteins into membrane. So now we go to the next one. And here we have an interesting territory, namely a new size. So we are going now from a few million atoms, including solvent. The rhizome has just about 300,000 atoms, and when you put it in solvent, you have about 2 to 3 million to simulate. We go now to a system called the virion, and a virus capsid that has, when you take everything together, about 60, 70 million atoms that you need to simulate to describe it. And so we wrote a proposal to do this work, and we got all referees said, don't do it, absolute waste of time, the worst thing you can do, and the only thing we allow you to do it is to do coarse graining. Now the message will be for you that, of course, I want to show that the people, referees who have the truth but to disagree with me that they are a low life, that I want to show you that that's, of course, they were wrong. But the message is very simple. The message is the following. The message is that at all levels of life, going from a small protein like myoglobin, the first crystallized, to the ribosome, a pretty big one, you realize chemical detail is very, very important. You cannot throw things away. And detail matters. And so if you coarse grain, you immediately, before you even start, you say, oh, detail doesn't matter this time. If you go to bigger systems, they are crucial for the cell, and you cannot do this. And so now let's look quickly at a case of a very, very huge system where you will see that this detail is absolutely crucial. And so here you see from the laboratory of Briggs at Embel in Heidelberg, this beautiful electromicrograph, tomogram of a virion with a capsid inside. And this is the model that we made of it. And we are actually interested in this here only in the capsid. The capsid is actually made of hexameric and pentameric elements. And so if you want to describe it, we have to describe some hexamers surrounded by hexamers, or we have to describe pentamers surrounded by hexamers. How do we know? There's a famous theorem, one of the few times in biology that you come across a mathematical theorem by Euler, who says that you can make with hexagons and pentagons an enclosed envelope. You need exactly 12 pentamers and any number of hexamers. And when we did our analysis with tomographs, we realized that we need about 186 hexamers and, of course, 12 Euler pentamers. And so first we made then, this is a collaboration with Pei-Jun Zhang and Angela Grunenborn from Pittsburgh. We made first tubes. We grew tubes that only contained hexamers. They were not closed because there were no pentamers, so they didn't close on themselves. And that permitted us, by taking electromicrographs of them, to see the electron density. And then we could use the molecular dynamics flexible fitting method. You see, we could fit we knew from crystallographic data that the individual proteins, individual capsid protein, would fit it in there and got a nice fit. And you see also that the protein follows the tubular shape of our tubes there very well, right radius and so on. Now this was, here we had good data from electron microscopy. For the pentamers it was harder. There were not really data. You couldn't make crystals of pentameric systems and so on. And so we actually just simulated them. And to our happy surprise, the simulation went very, very beautifully, exactly what we expect would happen under the best circumstances where we knew there should be interaction spots. There were interaction spots. And so we thought, oh, looks like we got this pentamer surrounded by 5 hexamers also correctly described. And so then we could put it all together. We had 186 hexamers, 12 pentamers, and we had 4.2 million atoms on the protein side. and we put it then into solvent, and we got then 64 million atoms to simulate. We simulated for a whole microsecond. The system was stable, and so we think we got the right protein, we got the right system, and there were some very interesting aspects. The first aspect is that the proteins, because of this sort of regular but also irregular shape of the surface, are actually all individuals. No protein is the same in this capsid. And so we have a distribution of proteins. And for example, one property that you find is the bite angle, the angle between two adjacent planes. And so the hexamers have a certain distribution of bite angles. When we look at the whole system, the pentamers have a much sharper bite angles. And they have this distribution. So the proteins have actually individual characteristics, which is not too surprising for protein chemists, because we knew that they have substates, and that one knows from enzymes that some proteins are in an active state and some proteins just are not in an active state, so they can be distributed. Now, we also understood the detail with which this curvature property is being controlled. And there's a certain juxtaposition of amino acids that is critical. So we grew these tubular forms under certain conditions. And that was sort of like the native in vitro form. And then when we change the mutation, as suggested by the simulation, then we got rounded forms, because then we got the much stronger ability of these systems to form sharper curvature and pentameric situations so that they could actually close the vesicle. Here you see that we could see that capsid surface is actually an osmotic exchange regulator for chloride ions. Also, we saw it for sodium ions. But now, what did we learn about the actual infection process? That was, of course, the goal of the work. And it turned out that the HIV capsid, when it enters the host cell upon infection, that it has to actually strike a bargain with the host cell. It needs factors of the host cell to reach the nucleus, because the HIV infects non-dividing cells. And so it has to inject its genetic material through the nuclear pore into the nucleus. And so it needs to interact with the nuclear pore, and it needs to be guided there. And that only happens when a certain host factor, namely cyclophilin A, and also some other host factor that you see here, are interacting with the capsid. Now the cell tried to prevent this, and the cell tries to prematurely, before the capsid reaches the nuclear pore, to uncoat it. And it has some other cell factors that are doing that job. And now the virus capsid wants to prevent it. And now we learned how this actually seems to happen. When we placed the cyclophilin onto the capsid, then we found that it has a certain binding motif there that leads to a certain pattern of the cyclophilin. So you think that it's completely covered with cyclophilin. No. It has a certain pattern of the coverage that is good enough to interact with the nuclear pore complex, but not every position is being placed. So there is a certain pattern there. And that pattern comes about through interactions that are critical that we could see only actually when we use the absolute most modern force field, namely a polarizable force field with atomic polarizability. We use the Drude force field. Then we got this interaction properly described in agreement with two-dimensional NMR measurements. And so we see now how this capsid is covered by cyclophilin. And now what do we find? We find that's the pattern that they actually adopt the cyclophilin on the capsid is such that there is a good interaction with the nuclear pore proteins, but another cell factor that is instrumental in breaking apart the capsid, namely E2, cannot bind anymore. The E2 has to bind in a certain pattern to cut out pieces of the capsid. And these patterns cannot be realized because of those bloody patterns that the capsid maintains through the cyclophilin binding. And so you see that we have really here a very intelligent chemistry and communication going on the surface of the capsid. So this is summarizing it, but the main point I want to make is that it was really essential that we studied the chemical detail. If we would have done coarse grain simulation, we would have seen none of this chemistry. And so my statement about early use of coarse graining is, you know, you cannot simplify before you understand. Once you understand it, do it. But you know, first you have to do the best possible simulation, even if the system is very large. And so now let me then come to the end. I hope it's pretty fast. And let me go here to... to this system. So we had now a system that was large, but every atom counted. And now I come to a system that's even a little larger, and even every electron counts. And this is a photosynthetic system. This is an organelle, or some people call it a pseudo-organelle because it's a very small cell organelle, in purple bacteria. Here you see this organelle. It absorbs sunlight and turns it into the synthesis of ATP. How do we know the structure of it that I show there? 40 years of work. But key is are the following methods. Atomic force microscopy, to image actually the protein on the surface, electron microscopy, mass spectroscopy to know what's there, optical spectroscopy, gold labeling, you name it, was integrated in these studies to end up after a very long process with a structure of with a typical structure of such an organelle. So we're working now on the level of an entire organelle. This was the collaboration with Neil Hunter at the University of Sheffield, long and wonderful collaboration. And so to do this, we had to first, of course, construct a model. And yes? Ah, I didn't. That is why I didn't get the movies. Thank you. Thank you. God, I was wondering. Okay, thank you. So now it rotates, my God, much prettier. Now you believe everything. So here you see now the simulation. And so we really simulated every atom there. And you see here, for example, the lipids moving. The lipids are really a key part of the function of the system, as you will see in a second. And we see the proteins moving. So everything is equilibrated and now for a long enough time that we know the system is actually stable and that we can trust it up to the level of the atom. And so we first want to study, and what you see now is a Hollywood movie, but based on science, and I will show you very, very few examples afterwards. So we see that light is absorbed and goes through excitation energy migration in the form of ring-like excitons through the system very, very quickly, within about 100 picoseconds, reaches then the reaction center there in blue, where the energy is utilized to transfer electrons and protons. Every photon, one electron, one proton. There comes another photon absorbed. Now the energy reaches, in this case, just for the purpose of the lecture here, it reaches the reaction center, and now we have enough photon energy stored there in the system. The first one is the green ones are called LH2. The red one is called LH1 inside the reaction center. Enough energy is reached that we can now turn a molecule of quinone into a molecule of quinole. And so here you see a quinone, and it becomes a quinole. Those of you who are chemists who know that quinole has two electrons and two protons more. Though this happens again, we're getting another excitation transfer in the form of these excitons that are many chlorophylls are excited at the same time. And so again, we can make another quinole out of quinone. And now this happens again and again, of course, at all the other reaction centers too. And now more and more quinone is being made. And that charges now the lipids where the quinones and quinoles are moving energetically. So it becomes red, meaning here that the quinone-quinole pool is just becoming energy charged. And so that is our first reservoir into which the system pumps energy to have sort of like a supply that it doesn't depend on light fluctuations during the day in the life of the bacterium and so on. Now, this energy reservoir is, however, not the only one. The system now uses a second reservoir, and that involves the molecule called the BC1 complex. The BC1 complex does the opposite. It takes a quinole and turns it back into quinone. So it does it by taking electron and protons away from the quinone and making then the quinone back into quinone. And so after a while, the energy is used to pump protons into the interior of this vesicle. And so now the dark blue shows you that we have now a second energy pool charged, namely a proton gradient. And now probably all of you know the rest of the story, that proton gradient is used actually by ATP synthase. The ATP synthase is using the proton gradient. The Mickey Mouse description here utilizes to synthesize ATP. Now, this is a very unusual lecture for you. This guy, why do you talk about all these things? You will find out. I think that our field of biophysics will be changing quite a bit in the following sense, that we will be studying systems. And when you study systems, you cannot just say, oh, I pick one process in the system. I have to say, I want to understand the system. So I have to study every process that contributes and interlocks with other processes in order to understand the system. And so in systems biophysics, you cannot go and look at your pet method, use your pet method and look at your pet molecule, but rather you have to use your pet system and then do everything you need to understand the system. And so this is what we are trying to do. And now I want to go very quickly with you through the kind of investigations that you see. There are many, many investigations. I worked on this system actually for 40 years. So, but don't get scared. I will be done in about five minutes. But I just would like to show you that you see that you have to investigate many, many aspects. So the first aspect is this LH2 protein that actually is not only a carrier of absorbing, of a function absorbing sunlight and then conducting the excitation energy to the reaction center. Rather, it also builds a house. And so it builds actually this sphere. And so you see, if we put six of these guys together in a membrane and simulate them, I just take the lipids away, let's see better, then you see they curve. And they curve in a radius that is exactly the one of the organelle that I showed. This is this is a spheroidal one. If you take different kind of LH2s, you're getting different curvatures. So this is your curvature as it develops over time, and you see that depending on the species, you get different curvature, which is brilliant, because you reach two things. First, proteins in a membrane like to go with proteins that have the same curvature, so proteins find each other more easily. Second, you're getting the right stoichiometry per organelle, because how many proteins fit into the sphere depends on the curvature. If you want to get more proteins together, you just make a larger radius, a smaller curvature. So this is one. Now it turns out the LH1 reaction center also contributes to the curvature. If you look at the electron density for this complex, and you're putting in with molecular dynamics flexible fitting the simulation, then you are getting the membrane along with the protein curved. If you now take the electron density away, the system remains curved, and so the system has a stable curved geometry, curving also the lipids in the immediate vicinity. It's very interesting when you look at this very carefully, you see that there's not only this kind of curvature, but there's also a little tilt to it. And this tilt we could actually verify by growing tubes just from these LH1 RC complexes. And we found that these tubes are just normal tubes, but they have a certain ellicity which is connected with this little tilt. And so this little tilt was completely correctly predicted from the simulation as verified by these helicities in these two tubes. So now, however, more the function of the LH2 to absorb sunlight. Now here, I am proud to say that, you know, usually in the old days, my physics colleague said, oh, what is a biophysicist? A biophysicist talks biology to physicists and physics to biologists. Now I tell them, you're a great, smart, super-duper solid-state physicist. What are you doing when you come mornings in the lab? You pour liquid helium over everything because you don't want to have the temperature around. Not in biology. If I pour liquid helium over anything living, that's the end of it. So we have to do quantum physics at finite temperature. They hate that because it's too complicated for them. But we have to do it. And here you see this LH2, you see how it rattles. It works like a Swiss watch with all the parts rattling. Isn't that impressive? And that is what nature learned with. Nature learned to do its quantum physics at finite temperature. Physicists are very excited about it because they want to work quantum computers at room temperature. Now they're coming flocking to this field. So we can predict the spectrum of the LH2, the higher excitation due to the blue chlorophylls and the lower one to the green. And now let's see what happens at excitation once the chlorophyll absorbs. We are forming excitons. We see that these ring chlorophylls are coherently excited. So this happens as follows, that when we have, for example, a carotenoid that is near chlorophyll excited, and we excite it. This actually, you see here, is a paper from 1972 in little Klaus Schulten, 25 years old, was at Harvard University with Martin Karplus, and he discovered these electronic excitations here. I don't want to go too much into it, except that something dramatic happens, I tell you now, namely that within 100 femtoseconds, the energy distributes. Some of it jumps to the chlorophyll right away into the so-called QX state. Some goes very quickly down through to the bottom of the carotenoid. Some ends up in the QY state. This one here also ends up in the QY state. Now we have one chlorophyll excited. But the chlorophyll is closely interacting with other chlorophylls in the ring in these LH2s, so that now they share the excitation in the terms of excitons. And these excitons, I told you, finite temperature quantum physics, is actually turning into Boltzmann distribution. And it is this Boltzmann distribution that is actually here. You see the Boltzmann distributed exciton state that is doing the excitation transfer very, very well. So even though there is this thermal disorder, we have a strong coherency of this ring. And now there's a phenomenon called superradiance that tells you that if we have n chlorophylls interacting with another ring of n chlorophylls, the excitation strength is n squared higher than if the chlorophylls would interact with the other chlorophylls independently. Not quite n squared, so you lose some here, you lose some there, but basically it is much stronger through superradiance, and that's what nature uses. And so here you see this process. We excite one LH2, we immediately go to this exciton ring, the exciton jumps, we can calculate the transfer time, we can measure the transfer time, it agrees very nicely. It jumps then into very, very odd exciton, namely this ring, this figure 8 kind of exciton, and then to the reaction center. And there the energy is used. And these processes happen very quickly because we have to get there before the energy is fluorescing away. And you see also some interesting oddity that to get to the reaction center is slow, to get away from the reaction center with the energy is fast. Looks like stupid, but brilliant. Because if there would be too much sunlight, you would burn all the reaction centers. But since you have, when you go to the reaction center, you very quickly go away, you distribute all the excitations equally almost over the entire organelle, and so you don't burn it at certain spots. You can put this all into some elegantissimo theory, and you can compare the experiment. You can compare the lifetime of the excitons, which is related to the probability that an exciton actually puts its energy in the reaction center. And so you find the lifetime is 100 picosecond calculated and between 80 and 100 picosecond measured. So this process is pretty well described at the electronic level over the entire organelle. Now, if we go to the BC1 complex, we learned that it transfers electrons and protons together. Here you see the quinole with two OH groups, and here you see the quinone, no OH group, so each of the two protons, namely an electron, and each of the two hydrogens, an electron proton, have to be taken away. Electron-proton transfer, and here you see how it happens. You see here the wave functions that take one electron to the protein side group called the iron sulfur protein, where the electron jumps. And you see here in purple how the proton jumps. And so you see that you have a coupled process that is also described here. It's a quantum mechanical electronic level with temperature correct and so on. Now, the electrons that are being brought to the BC1 complex through the quinole, so they're brought there, they have to be brought back. And so to understand that, we have to understand the electrostatics inside of this organelle. So here we simulate this organelle, and so this was a little bit what I showed earlier, and what you see here is that the red LH1s are much looser than the green LH2s. So LH2s are smaller, very rigid. The bigger ones are loose because they have to permit passage of quinone and quinoles to the reaction center and out. And now comes some very, very exciting detail. Now we have to get the electrons back from the BC1 complex to the reaction center. And to do this, we utilize a protein called cytochrome C2. The cytochrome C2 is an electron carrier, and it docks with its positive side to the BC1 complex and to the reaction center. And what you see here is the electrostatic pattern, how it changes around the physiological salinity. And you see that right at this point, you are seeing particular clear patterns of electrostatic potential on the surface of the membrane. And that's very critical because the cytochrome C2 has to go to the BC1 complex. When it is reduced, when an electron is waiting, take it on. Once it has taken it on, it has to leave it. It has to be pushed away by the BC1 complex. Then it has to find the reaction center that is waiting for an electron according to the pattern and give it there. So there's a very important communication transport process that has to go effectively on. And these organelles actually utilize just five cytochrome C2s usually. So the cytochrome C2 seems to be helicoptering very, very well to do this process. And you see also that the process is completely geared to the salinity, to the native salinity that we have in our cells. And so here you see the process of docking. You see that we dock, we have a wonderful complementary surfaces, in this case between BC1 and the cytochrome C2. You see here the two heme groups, one from the BC1 on the top and from the cytochrome C2, how edge go within 5 angstrom, less than 5 angstrom, perfectly attuned. This is nanostructure engineering at its absolute best. Of course, billion years of evolution had a lot of time to achieve this. We also see that we agree nicely with experiment. If we calculate the binding constants, we are getting, so I covered it now up here a little bit, we're getting binding constants that are changing before transfer and after transfer, good before transfer, after transfer, bad binding, and the magnitude of the calculations are very good. They're not really perfect, but at that level, I think one cannot expect really better numbers. Probably in 10 years, we will not have better numbers than that. So finally, the ATP synthase. That's, of course, a great system, important system, and many here are very interested in it. And that actually system that got me into biophysics to begin with when I was young. And so here we have this the top part of the ATPase. And we know what it's doing. We have a stalk in there, and the stalk rotates. And thereby it induces ATP synthesis calculations. Why do I think I do this right? This is here a little piece of the simulation. The reason is actually that we recently did a dramatic advance with a related protein, namely rho helicase, also hexameric helicase. It's not rotating a stalk, but it's pumping RNA through its center. And this is a calculation that will come out in JAX in a few weeks. And that is showing the intricate organization, coordination, and mechanical force delivery that moves the RNA through the system, entirely based on the methodology that is called transition path sampling that permitted us to describe this millisecond process. We used a variant of it of Benoit Roux called the string method and Ron Elbas' milestoning method, and that permitted us to calculate even the rates of this process. And so now we did the same for ATP synthase, and we hope that again we will get very nice results. And first results look very nice. For example, one can leave the stalk out. People have done experiments like this, and the system is not as stable, but it still is working, and works in fact very similarly with and without the stalk. And we find that the free energy diagram that describes the rotation of the stalk looks very similar for the system when the stalk is gone. And so, definitely our system can do stalk-free motion. And when we are looking at the detailed steps intermediates, and we find that two of the intermediates that we identified were also identified crystallographically before. They are called here 1 and 3, and you see that they are very close in value. The RMSD values are 2.2 and 2.5 angstrom, so we identified the right intermediates. So finally, we want to understand the entire system, namely what is the rate and efficiency of the synthesis of ATP as a function of light intensity. And we could actually describe it. The system is mainly describable, even though it's so complicated, because one can assume stationary conditions for the process. And then it's actually pretty straightforward to describe, and you need very few parameters that you need to identify through simulation or take from experiment. And so then we got this characteristic that shows us that already at very low illumination, which are typical for the habitat of these purple bacteria, we are getting already a very impressive ATP synthesis rate, whereas we don't gain more when we go to higher illumination, which are atypical for the environment of these purple bacteria. Namely, the system is optimized so that it dissipates energy when the intensity is too high. And so this is now my summary slide. You see here now the processes in the system. The the light harvesting, the electron transfer, the proton transfer, the ATP synthesis, and I told you that we want to understand the biophysics of the system, not of some piece of it. And so we must put all these processes together that are working like a clockwork to understand it. We cannot pick our systems anymore by method and by molecular preference, but rather we should really go and see how this kind of interlocking action is coming about in the various impressive systems we find in living cells. And so I finish now with putting the thing all together back into the cell. Here you see where it's actually located in a cell. There are in a typical purple bacterial cell hundreds of these chromatophores. So you see here a few more. And so this is now the true system biophysics view that we have. And now I want to acknowledge the people. Oh, now I went too quick. So I want to acknowledge people. First, my group again. Though the many of the group members presently contributed, I put the key names of the players onto the various slides, so I don't want to point them out. Again, I want to thank the National Science Foundation for long-term funding, particularly also Kamal, very, very nice to see him here being awarded, and also the physics program of NSF for our Center for Physics of Living Cells, the NIH that funded the development of the software. You see here the key collaborators, Hermann Gaup in Munich, and Neil Hunter in Sheffield, and Peijun Zhang in Pittsburgh, at the University of Pittsburgh, Chris Chipot, who helps us with doing free energy calculations, other calculations, and conceptually advancing NMD, and Ilya Solovyov, now in Odense earlier, a postdoc, who is doing the quantum chemistry calculations that I was showing here, together with Angela Baragan, who is actually in the audience. Okay, good, and so at the end I want to advertise, and I'd like to thank you very much for your attention. Do you have questions? If we don't have questions, then I wish you a great party. Looking forward to see you there. But if somebody has an urgent question to this crazy modeler, then please ask. Otherwise, you can catch me at the party. See you guys.